I believe that local coaches, Turkish coaches are very, very high quality coaches, like Coach Ataman and all the other big coaches in European level. And I'm very honored that I will have this discussion here with you.
Thank you. Now it is your turn. We are waiting for your presentation and you can share the screen however you want.
Okay.
We are listening to you.
Let me share the screen and let's talk about basketball analytics, why we need them, and feel free to have any questions or now or in the end. Now, why do we need them? Why don't we just use points? Everybody writes it. ESPN uses it. Leonard scores 25 points, leads the Clippers past the Thunder. This is the headline. This is what everybody sees. Everybody's talking about the points. I'm sure that every coach of us, at some point in his career, he said, oh, this guy played great. He had 25 points. Why is the problem? The problem of the points is this. A 10 increase of points, 10% increase of points, increase 3.25% the playing time. When we increase the efficiency, the playing time is not increased as much. The points increase the salary. The efficiency does not increase the salary as much. The points increase the chances to get an all-star selection that we all know how important it is for Americans and this their basketball. Now, but this is the paradox of the points. We know that the points are not the best criterion for the evaluation. We know that they explain close to 60% of what the player gets. But teams, when they spend their money, they're not guaranteed to get a winning record. So it's winning that increases the money. It's winning that increases the revenue. And you know what? Points are not associated with winning. This is something that is paradox. And this is something that the efficiency of analytics is here to solve. Now, not every stat has the same value. This is a very big principle of analytics. When we talk about advanced statistics, we need to understand no stat has the same value. And it's very unfair to use the regular field goal percentage, because if we see, and this is data right before the stop of the NBA, Giannis Antetokounmpo, he is averaging 56.4% from the field, and PJ Tucker, 53.4%. We see that Giannis is maybe a better scorer or a better, more efficient scorer, but it's not. When the first metric that we'll talk about is effective field goal percentage, and this metric assigns the three-point shot the more value that it has over the two-point shots, because two-point shots is worth 2 points, three-point shot is worth 3 points, three-point shot is a better quality shot if you make it. So if we adjust it, the previous example, the effective field goal of Giannis is still pretty high, close to 60%, but the effective field goal of PJ Tucker turns it to 67.5. So we see how a player like PJ Tucker is so efficient in his team, because he provides, with his three-point shooting, 67.7% from the field. Guys, this is as you understand, a very big number. And if we look at the previous presentation, there is a huge difference between the 53.4 and the 67.7, close to 68%. Now, basketball is not only twos and threes. It's also free throws. And let's see this example for true shooting percentage. True shooting percentage is a metric that will calculate how many points you score from twos and threes and how many you get from the free throws. And this example is going to be very, very significant. Clint Capella, 63.7% from the field. Unbelievable number. James Harden, 43.6%, 20% difference. Everybody will say, oh, James Harden takes too many shots, he's not a winner, this and that. But if you adjust the game of James Harden with his threes and his free throws, look at the difference. There is a more than 20% points turnaround. So, which number is true? This number or this number? And the truth is in the second number, because the second number, true scoring percentage, calculates the fact that the players shoot not only from the field, shoot also from the free throw, and when they shoot from the field, twos and threes, threes have better value. Kawhi Leonard example. At that game that you saw that Kawhi Leonard scored 25 points and won the game from ESPN, a very credible ESPN, his effective field goal percentage was 50%. And Paul George might score a little bit less, but look how effective is the field goal percentage of his. And this is the league average. So Kawhi Leonard, just because he scored 25 points, got in the first page, he got all the attention of the world, and he's shooting less than the league average at that particular game. So that makes you thinking. Usage percentage, this is another metric that we like to see. Usage, it's an estimation of the percentage of the offenses that the player is using while on the floor. That's that it's a big equation that is available online. You don't need to memorize it. You just need to know that the metric exists. And this is some practical examples to understand how efficient players help the team win. And this is the top five in usage. The top five players in how much percentage of their offense they're using while on the floor. So Giannis, basically, he gets 37, close to 40% of the offenses that that his team is running when he's on the floor, it's taken by him. His effective field goal is number 17 in the NBA. That brought Bucks with the best record. Harden, very close to him, 53rd, Rockets 7th. Doncic, very close. Mavericks below. So you see that as they drop in efficiency, they drop in ranking. And look at Young. Young and Bradley Beal, and you see that their efficiency is lower than the rest of the other guys. And look at the ranking of Hawks and Wizards. They're one of some of the worst teams, but these guys, since they're playing and they're having the ball in their hands, they got selected to be the All-Star. And this is the unfairness of the system when you're not looking at the advanced metrics, as is effective field goal percentage. This you have to keep in your mind, and this is, if it's something that you need to get out of this lecture, is that stats can lie, but usually stats lie when you don't know what you're looking at. So if you're looking at field goal percentage, well, most likely you're going to be wrong. If you're looking at effective field goal, if you're looking at true scoring percentage, then most likely you will have it right. And now, we talked about the players. Let's talk a little bit about the team. Bucks, they score 119.1 points per game, and Mavericks 116.4. Which one is the better offense? Well, the answer to that, what would be? I don't know. I don't know which one is the better offense. You cannot compare how many points one team is scoring against the other team, because these are not comparable. These are not comparable metrics. In order to do that, in order to be able to compare this type of metrics, we need to have the term of possession. Because we don't know how many chances Mavericks had to score this point, how many chances the Bucks had to score this point. We don't know. This is a lie. If we say that this one or the other one is better, it's a speculation. Possession is this. You come from this part of the court to this part of the court, and that's one possession. While you can stay on this part of the floor, you can shoot, take the offensive rebound, kick it out, shoot again. That's still the same possession. You might have two shots, you might have two plays, as we said, but this is the possession. And how we calculate the possession is by this formula. We add the field goals, free throws attempted, times 0.44. This is a number that they found that is free throws that terminate the possessions. We add the turnovers, because turnovers terminate the possession, and we take out the offensive rebounds, because the offensive rebounds keep the possession being the same. So if we want to find out what's the possession, it's very simple calculation. Everybody can do it. You can do it on the bench. You can do it live. You can do it with your cell phones. It's very, very simple to calculate, to estimate how many possessions are at a game.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Sorry. You put there, I have two questions actually. 0.44. How you calculate and what it means? Why you use it on the formula?
There's been a big research getting data from 10 years in the NBA. They counted every free throw, because as you know, free throws can be one, like an end one. It can be two free throws after a shooting foul, after a bonus foul, or it can be three free throws. So we don't really know how many, what's the number of the free throws that finish the possession. So after they made this research, they figured out that if you calculate 0.44, it's a coefficient. If you calculate this with the number of the free throws, you will see how many free throws end the possession. This is an estimation. This is data from the NBA. There's been efforts to make it new with data from EuroLeague. This is a project that we do in Eurostats with cooperation with the university. So we'll soon find out if this coefficient exists still. But right now, everybody works with this coefficient, this 0.44. This is what you have to calculate, have to multiply the free throws with.
And is there any other formula that you believe before that formula? Because there are a couple formula to calculate for the possession as well. So
a couple of other formulas. These other formulas, what they do, they have regression equations. I don't want to bother you too much with technical technical things. So it's coefficient from regressions that are made. Studies are made in the American basketball. There is nothing that is the same with that has done work has been done in European data. So because we don't know if this data is true, we're using the most simple form, which is this form that we showed you right now.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. So if we go back to our example and see how many points each team is scoring per 100 possession, this is the offensive rating. So if we do that, we find out that the Mavericks score 117.0. This is points per 100 possessions. So if the game was played for 100 possessions, Mavericks would have scored 117. The Bucks would have scored 113. So despite the fact that the Bucks actually scored more points than the Mavericks has a more efficient offense. So the answer to our questions is the Mavericks. The Mavericks have a better and more efficient offense than Milwaukee, because they score more per possession than the Bucks do. And this is how we make a metric, a variable, that's how we make it comparable. Other examples, New Orleans, they're fourth in points scored, but they are 15th in offensive rating. And this is why we need the analytics. This is why when you go and structure your game and you play against a certain team and you say, okay, this team scores 116 points. I look at the ranks. They're fourth in the league. They have great offense. If you don't look at the offensive rating, if you don't calculate the offensive rating, you will not have the whole truth. This team that you overestimate, that's been fourth, actually it's 15th. Actually, it's in the middle of the pack. And it can be vice versa. You can have a very average team in terms of scoring and can be a very, very highly efficient team. So you need to know the offensive rating. You need to know the analytics before you make any type of decisions. Defensive rating, same procedure for defense. Bucks and Magic, they have the same pretty much points. They receive the same points. Somebody might say that, you know what? They're similar. They have similar differences. Well, it's not. Because Bucks defensive rating, Bucks receive in 100 possessions, 101 points. While the Magic, 108.7. So that means Bucks have the best offense in the best defense in the NBA. Magic, ninth. So you get the feeling, you get the feeling of what I want to say. Don't look at the numbers itself. It's deceiving. You need to have the analytics behind it. The same goes for every metric. For example, rebounding. The defensive rebound percentage and the offensive rebound percentage is different. So when we're talking about the defensive rebounds, we say, okay, this team is averaging, I don't know how many, 20 defensive rebounds. The other team is averaging 15 and so on. But you don't know how many chances there are for rebounds. And this is this formula, what this formula tells us. The defensive rebound over defensive rebound plus the opponent's offensive rebounds. So how many rebounds were in a basket and how many of them did we take back for defense and for offense? The expected average is teams need to have around 73% for defensive rebound and around 27% for offensive rebound. That's the expected average that you might have for a team. Let's look at examples. New Orleans, they take 11.1 offensive rebound. They're second in the league. But when you do the percentage, they're seventh. And they get 22.9. Now, assisted possessions versus assists. And this is an example where last year, I'm a big fan of FS basketball, because in this part, FS was the best team in EuroLeague last year. It's not the actual assist that matters, but the percentage of baskets that comes off assists. Golden State Warriors, they're 12th in the assists they make, but they're number two in percentage. So this is a very important metric. Do not stay on one number. Some of you might have heard like a first place of analytics, the four factors. Well, the four factors, just to make it simple for you to have it, is nothing simple. It's nothing strange. It's nothing complicated. It's the answer to the question that Dean Oliver gave to the world: how do teams win the game? And when teams win the game by making shots, by avoiding to turn the ball over, by going to the offensive rebound, and that's all three is possessions, and by going to the basket. So by putting together these four metrics gave an idea of what a team is doing in terms of how they handle the possession, how they score the possession, and if they lose it. So effective field goal, turnover percentage, offensive rebound percentage, and the free throw rate. This is an example of the free throw of the four factors. That's from EuroLeague. That's from our work in Neustats. And this is a random team. 60% is the best team in EuroLeague. 16.2%. It's one of the bottom teams in EuroLeague. 30% offensive rebounds. and 11th in the free throw rate. Free throw rate basically shows how many points you get when you go to the basket, when you go to the line, according to the possessions that you play. Now, when we go and we scout a game, what do we need in terms of analytics? We've seen all this. We have to start with offensive rating, defensive rating, this type of ratings to be in a percentage. And now, look at the opponent statistics, the team's defense, starts according to the home court, home or away, according to the result, wins or losses, according to the shape, 3 or 5 recent games, and we have these printouts like this, so you can all play with that. And this is before we go to the play-by-play statistics. This is an example of how play-by-play statistics is kept in EuroLeague. Now, play-by-play statistics is the future, and this is something that we all should be comfortable with using, because this is the best source of analytics that we can find and will help us to our decisions more than anything else. Play-by-play statistics, I can't stress it enough. I will give you an idea of what they are and how to use them, but please go on, search about it. This is a great, great feature to have knowledge of. The first play-by-play statistics that we like to see is what we call on-off statistics. On-off statistics will give you two things. One, what the team was doing while this specific player, Anthony Randolph, was on the court, and what the team was doing when Anthony Randolph was off the court. So when we see right now, if we see right now, the offensive rating, when Anthony Randolph was on the court, his team was averaging 10 more points in the offensive rating than when he was off the floor. So that means that this guy helped the team play good offense, helped his teammates play good offense. And this is something that we need to know when we go for a player. On the other hand, look at this, defensive rating. He wasn't that efficient when he was on the floor in the defensive end for his team. But overall, if we count this, he's a plus. In the 24 minutes, 23.7 minutes that he played, in the 47 possessions that he played, Real Madrid was consistently winning the opponents because they were playing better offense, and their defense was not as bad. So Anthony Randolph, you understand how important player he is, because when he plays, it doesn't matter what he does while he's on the floor. It doesn't really matter. It's not about his personal contribution. The team plays better with him on the floor, and that's what you need to know. The same way that you can evaluate a player, you can evaluate a team of 5 players, a lineup. And now, this is the best lineup of Real Madrid. Campazzo at the 1, Rudy at the 2, Taylor at the 3, Randolph at the 4, Tavares at the 5. This is the offensive rating they had, and look how great of a difference they played. 89.5 points per 100 possessions. They were averaging offensive field goal, and this is the 4 factors. If you go into more details, and you can have more details, and I'll show you around in our website, you will find a combination of players. Everybody says, I'm sure that you've said it, these guys don't play well with each other. And I'll use an example of, which is not true, actually. Some might say, Mitic cannot play together with Larkin, or Larkin is not playing together with Dunston very well. That's a way to find out how teams of players of 2, 3, and 4 play together on the court. See now, Sergio Llull. when he plays with Tompkins, his team is averaging 5.5 points over the opponent. They're winning more. They're winning their opponent by 5.5 points. An unbelievable amount of offensive rating. Their offense between Hewlett and Tompkins is great. Of course, the games are not that many, but if you take out, for example, Eddie Tavares and Sergio Yul, they're not playing that many minutes together. And their offense is not that great. For some strange reason, some might say that Tavares and Yul doesn't make the offense of Real play better. Actually, it is worse, 7.3 points per 100 possession than when they're not playing together. And that's why they only play 7 minutes in the game. So things, winning teams, there are secrets of the chemistry and the way that they use players. And if you really look for it in the statistics, if you look, you really look for it in the analytics, it's there. It's there for you to see. So if somebody might ask, oh, why not Yul is not playing together with Tavares? Yul is a great player. Tavares is a great player. Why they don't play good together? You know what? They don't play good together because of this. And that's why they only play 7 minutes. And Tavares is playing more with Campazzo because the team is playing better. The team is functioning better, as we can see from here. Now, let's assume that we have the information, right? Now we have to need to show it. So the visualization of the information will save you a lot of very precious time. And I will show you examples of how the statistics of spacing, timing, and efficiency can be put together in a map, can be visualized, so you can see it right away. This is the special statistics of Golden State Warriors in the season 18-19. Now, if you look at this, you will see the accuracy, how accurate they were in comparison to the average of the NBA. And this is, the blue is how bad they were in comparison to the average of the NBA. And we can see that this area of threes, this area of mid-range was working very well for them. So right away, when you look at the heat map, if I was to play against the Golden State Warriors and I wanted to shed a little bit out of their percentage or get them a little bit out of the comfort zone, right away, what would I do? I would force them on this side of the court. I would try to force them on this side of the court. I would try to keep them out of the corners, try to minimize as much as I can their impact inside the arch, inside the paint, and force them to this side. Top of the key threes, in between areas, in this side. This, by just looking at one image, will help me understand if it's the best side or the bad side. So when they go down, all the left pull-ups, all the left turnouts, all these places, it's very, very dangerous. So I would probably do something to lead them the other way. The same way, this is Vasilis Spanoulis' visualization. You see, everybody knows, okay, if everybody doesn't know, I will tell you that he likes the right pull-up. He loves the right pull-up. And you can see it right here. He loves top of the key shots. He likes right pull-ups. He never goes to the corners. And he is average in the in-between area. So he likes right pull-ups and right drives, as we see from this color. And so when you see a heat map like this, and this is a lot of games, and you can experiment with the situation, then you know what to do. You don't want to force Spanoulis to the right. You don't want him to go to the right because he's extremely dangerous. You want to take him out of his comfort zone, make him far left, force him to the corner, keep him on these areas, force him to take shots from in between where he doesn't like to take shots and where probably he's not as successful. But if he gets in the paint and if he goes for the right drive, you know what? Most chances are that he's going to be successful and you're going to be ending up with some problems guarding him. Another thing I'm sure that you've heard, it's a saying that everybody has in the team. You come, a player comes to you and you tell him something, or why don't you shoot like this? Why don't you are more aggressive? And they come to you and they say, you know what, coach? The first guy won't give me the ball. He won't pass me the ball. And you're thinking and you're kind of worrying and you're saying, well, is it true? Is it not true? And this statistic right here will show you if this is true or not. Because you see the stats of Klay Thompson, and you can see the stats of anybody. We just pick a selection of NBA, and you see who passed him and for what type of stats. So corner threes of Klay Thompson came mostly from Kevin Durant, Draymond Green, Steph Curry, and very, very limited from Andre Iguodala. If you see the lines, I don't know if it's that obvious in your computer or not. So you know who is passing to whom. If Klay Thompson says that Kevin Durant doesn't pass me the ball, well, he'd be a liar, because Kevin Durant passing the ball for a short two, for a long two, for a corner three, Kevin Durant is passing the ball. So the same as Draymond Green. See the big, big line of passes leaving from Draymond Green's part, going to Klay Thompson's part. So you know who is passing to whom. And this is also very important to see. The point guards, the decision, the distributors, the passers in this team was Kevin Durant and Draymond Green. Something that you might have as a feeling, something that you might experience from your past, something that you hear talking on the internet or in coffee houses or in places where fans get together, that this guy is not passing to what or whatever, or this guy is not playing well with each other. We see that with analytics, we have this information. We have it. It's there. The same for a league. You see out of each position, which one is the best player. Best player for finishing under the basket, Giannis. You can have the same for a team. You're playing against Efes. Who is good from this area? Who is good from that area? Who is good from under the basket? And how does this compare to the average? They might be good, but they might be good being below average. So this is the thing that you need to be aware of. It exists. It's out there. It's not something crazy. Now, look at this. This is LeBron James. LeBron James, how he shoots from the ball. How he shoots the ball. He shoots the ball under the basket, 63%. He takes top of the key threes, 31%. Sometimes he goes the corner. 37% from this side. So if we play against LeBron, take him out of the paint. Take him out of the paint. Force him right. Force him to this area. Force him, keep him on the top. Make him shoot the top of the key three. Contest him. Force him to the corners. And this is where he passes the ball. So this guy gets 25 points per game, and 27 points per game comes via assists. He passes for a layup, and he passes for a corner three. So every time we see a penetration of LeBron James and we want to cut off his side, his passing, what we need to be aware of, he's passing for a layup, he's passing in this corner more than anything else. So somebody who's up there, come back and help, because he's not going to stop and pass back to him. These little details will help you have a better game plan, will help you have an advantage for a game plan over your opponent, because you know, you don't think that something strange might happen. No, you know that LeBron James, when he penetrates or when he's inside or when he wants to pass, he's not going to stop and pass back to him. Never. He'll go on and find the corner. He won't go on and find the big man. Take that away from him. Help someone with some other ways. And I'm using LeBron. It could be any player. Now, another thing that we can have is we can have a report for a player, and we can compare him to the league. We can see how stable he is doing that. If somebody is familiar with statistics or simple statistics, I don't want to be bothering you with technicalities. There is a meaning of standard deviation, which means how much his average deviates left and right. For example, a very simple example could be if somebody has a 10-point average and he is usually shooting either 10 points or 12 points, is a more stable player than somebody who is 10-point average, but one time he might be scoring 19, and the other time he might be scoring 1. So this is stability and instability, and we can have it and we can present it in a way that he can be compared with other players in his position. Now, this I like the most. This I really like the most because this is visualization of playing time, and I'm sure that with 1 second you can understand how Real Madrid started the games and how Real Madrid finished the games. That's from 2 years ago, the data. Randolph, he started every single game. He's a player that played this minute is the first quarter, second, third, and fourth. He played all the times, dark blue color, in the first quarter. He played all the times in the third quarter, and he might be in the game for the last couple of minutes. Same with Yul, first and third. Same with Kozer, first and third. Same with Taylor, first and third. Same with Tavares, first, third, and a little bit fourth. And now, who closed the games for Real Madrid? Who were the closers of Real Madrid that was very, very important? Campazzo, second and fourth. Rudy, second and fourth. Sorry. Trey Tompkins, second and fourth. And maybe a little bit Ayon, maybe a little bit Tavares. The other ones were interchangeable. So three of the players were key players for Real Madrid that were in the game in the last minutes. Maybe Jesse Carroll too, which is never started the game, played a little bit in the second, and when he needed to, he played more in the fourth than in any other quarter. So by looking at 1 minute, you don't need more than that. You need 1 minute, and you understand the rotation and the chemistry of Real Madrid. Guys, this is something that a few years ago we never had, and this is something that we couldn't have had if we didn't have play-by-play statistics. Everything that we've shown so far is coming from play-by-play statistics, and this is why it's very, very important to know and to have. The same way, we're not talking about game time, we're talking about scoring. And this is how Real Madrid is scoring. Andre Arnold scores the first quarter, scores the third quarter, maybe a little bit at the end. Yul scored, this is from a different season. Yul scored in the end, Campazzo scored in the end. Again, we see how important Campazzo is for this team of Real Madrid. This is actually from this year, the previous one was from the 2 years ago. Another thing that we have, this is a league. This is a work that we did.
The previous table.
This one.
Is 5 minute intervals, right? And total.
This is 5 minutes interval. Yes. This is now, every box is 5 minutes.
So, let's say, Anthony Randolph. At the first 5 minutes of. How many games? 50 points, like let's say.
This is 10 games, the first 10 games.
First 10 games, first 5 minutes, he scored 50 total points.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
Exactly. Thanks for the clarification. I went a little bit sooner on this. And this is from the World Cup. And you see the teams in terms of the offensive rating, the defensive rating, the pace, assist percentage, assist to turnover, effective field goal, turnover percentage, offensive and defensive rebound percentage, and free throw rate. So right now you see at the top 11 teams on the World Championship, and just by seconds, you see exactly which ones were the better teams. Real Madrid had a very good, Real Madrid, Spanish team had an excellent defense. Serbia had a very good offense, but the defense was not that great. The American team, it was pretty average on both ends, maybe a little bit better defense. That's why they didn't have good results, and so on. And I would also like to show you just a couple of things that we have new in your stats. And when we look at, you still watch my screen, right? At Fenerbahce, we see all these things that we discussed about, four factors. We see the roster, we see the games, we see the heat map, points scored and minutes played and everything is in there. We see the on-off statistics for every single player. We see the lineups and everything that's come with them. And with a click of a button, if you click this button, immediately you get this report. This report will show you the roster, will show you the last results, will show you how the team is reacting on four factors, how they compare with the opponents in traditional stats and advanced stats, how they're scoring, the heat map, and how each player ranks with the competition. So you can have this with a click, just have some key elements if you don't want to create your own reports like this, or you can have a table like this and it shows you with green color the players immediately that stand in its category. For example, the seven shots that Jan Vesel is taking is way above the average of the league, but his free throws, 51%, is way below the average of the league. So you know what to expect in terms of who is overperforming and who is underperforming in this team. So that would be all from my side. If you have any questions to ask, I'll be happy to answer. The whole question is this, though. Try to look for the right way to say the truth. The numbers have always the solution for us. And if you stay with traditional numbers, sometimes you might be wrong. You might be overestimating the value of points, and you might underestimating the value of efficiency. And what made FS great the last couple of seasons in EuroLeague, if you study their stats, is that FS was not a fancy team. They were not a team that they had great games, but they were not a fancy team. They were a very, very efficient team, a very effective team in most of statistical categories. And this is what made them, gave them the wins. This is what gave them the advantage, the fact that they were very, very efficient. So, that's all for me. If you want to have any questions, I'll be glad to answer, and I will stop sharing my screen so I get a chance to see you guys.
Hi, Coach. This is Ahmet. Thanks for joining us. I have two questions. One of them, is that a full account or just basic account of that site, New Stats?
No, you can have it as a no. We have as a basic some things, and full account is more things, and we're working on customizing.
Yeah.
If you have any offers or if you have any questions that you want to be customized, that you want to see, like whatever you want to see, we can provide.
Yes. I was asking about your sources, Pete, and where do you get these stats? But I think there is an answer. My second question is, I think reading stats is more important, analyzing them. What kind of mindset do you have when you analyze a game or player? What are your priorities?
Great question. Because great question. I will answer you that.
There are lots of combined stats to analyze. That was my question. Thank you very much.
Great question. Thank you very much. What we analyze, what we do this, in everything that we do, there is a so-called bet. You know, there is two percentages that one is never 50-50. One is 60%, the other one might be 40. The one is 70%, the other one might be 30. So we try every time when we make a selection to base our selection on data and go with what is less percentage every time. So if we see a heat map, and we see that this player is great on the right side and he's shooting, for example, 60%, and from the left side he's shooting 30%, then we're going to force him left. We're going to keep on forcing him left. If he beat us, he will beat us by having to make something great, something way more than his average. So every time what we do, we try to find the percentages and we take the higher and we leave the slower percentage to our opponent. And we do this in every aspect of the game. Wherever we have to make a dilemma, whenever we have to choose between those two scenarios, we calculate the percentage for one scenario and the percentage of the other scenario, and we keep the high one. This is the action for all tactics. This is how we play pick and roll defense. A team is playing, for example, has a very low 30% in between game, and they have a great three-point game, 40%, maybe more. We're not going to go heads out on them. We're going to go flat, and we're going to let them shoot in between game, because they make with 30, and we win with the other 70, if you know what I'm saying. So everything, every decision that we made is based on statistics, and it's based of us having the most percentage of the other team.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, coach.
No problem.
I have a question, coach.
Yes.
For lineup statistics.
Yes.
For example, the example you showed, especially when you pair two players, not five player lineup but two players.
Yes.
Is there a way to subtract the playing time that wasn't so important in the result of the game?
Yes, you can do this.
20 minutes, 20 point game, last 6-7 seconds, that I don't want to see this.
Yes, you can sort by criteria. You can create the criteria that you want to see. They say, for example, I want to see close games. I want to see last 5 minutes with this type of difference. You can create this type of sorted, and you will find this type of statistics. It's not available online yet, but it's happening. It will be happening for our site. That's what I mean. But this is way
is
to...
Is it again possible with step by step... What was it? I forgot.
Play by play.
Is it?
Yes. Everything is play by play. Everything is play by play. We can make this. We can make the criteria that we want. We can select a filter, for example, and we say we want to see all away games that finish with difference of 5 points.
Mm-hmm.
And we can see the combinations there. So we take away all the garbage time, because this is very, very important what you said. Garbage time can alter the results, and you might think that the guy is super scorer, and he scored it when the game was 15 points difference or 10 points difference. You know what I'm saying? So maybe, yes, play by play, only play by play can do this.
Maybe two young guys who play five games per game could end up the best player in the team because of this garbage time.
And if you want, you can take away the young guys. You can take away these guys of the garbage time. You just throw them out of all because they can change the statistics. Exactly.
Thank you. Thank you, coach.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Coach, I have two questions. One of them, how you, as an assistant coach, how you convince the player to use those stats and to affect their performance during the game? And how you convince the head coach as well? Because, you know, they have many things in their shoulder. Sometimes they may say, okay, you did a good job, but there are some more chemistry things that I have to handle. So convince is a more important art for you guys who read the stats. So how you convince the player and how you convince the head coach to use the effect of the stats?
I pretty much use the same way for players and for coaches. It's very important that both of them are part of the plan that you have in your mind. Both players, if players don't support it, it's not going to work. Whatever coach, even if the head coach supports it, if the players don't support it, it's not going to work. And I tell them this. I tell them, okay, if you let this guy shoot the three-point shot, this is a 60% chance that he will make it. If you force him in the paint, this is a 40% chance that he will make it. So it's up to you. What do you want to do? If you want to listen to me, if you want to listen to what I'm saying, this guy will go and you will shoot a low percentage shot. If you don't listen to what I'm saying, this guy will go and shoot a very high percentage shot. Numbers is something that players very easily understand. They will not understand something very difficult, but if you tell them, okay, if you do this, this is 20, and if this happens, this is 80, then they're not stupid. They will go for the 20. So in every chance, because all kids right now, you know, all the players, they are looking at percentages, looking at their numbers. They are, some of them even looking for betting. Everybody knows about percentages. It's something very simple to tell them that this is a high percentage solution. This is a low percentage solution. You take the choice. I'm not going to take the choice for you. I'm going to tell you that this and this, you choose. And if you tell them this, then most likely they will choose the right questions. I always try to make the players co-workers. We are together with this. We try to solve the problem together. And I will give you the intelligence, and you are the soldiers who are going to make it happen. I've never had a problem with a player because of this reason. Never.
Okay, thank you. Yakup, onu tercüme edebilir misin? Ben İngilizcemde sorayım mı? Mikrofonun açık değil.
İlk kısmını anlayamadım hocam. İlk Moneyball kısmını. There is a question, Christos, but we are trying to translate it.
Okay.
You know, these baseball teams use stats. Also, NBA teams also use stats.
Of course.
GMs especially, the front office especially, to compose the roster. Mm-hmm. Is it also possible to do it in Europe? Just by using stats, numbers, to make the correct lineup, correct roster?
Yes. Yes, there is a way to do it. The first people who started using statistics for decision making was baseball many years ago. You've all seen Moneyball, the movie,
yes,
and how it works. basketball started about 2010, 2012, making this type of decisions. Mm-hmm. And yes, in Europe, we can make this. We can make this type of solutions. We can figure out, for example, if a player is coming from a league in Finland, we can predict how they can perform if they play in EuroLeague. Mm-hmm. We could predict how we'll give you, we're not going to give you exact number of who scored 12 points, but we'll give you that this guy has a 70, 80% chance of him becoming a key player in the EuroLeague team. Or he, this guy has a 20% chance of becoming a key player in the team. So there are solutions. There are many techniques. And now we're trying, we are working a lot with new stats, with machine learning and artificial intelligence. So we have a lot of these options trying to predict the performance of a player in the future for a league, for a different team. For there's a lot of things that can be done in this direction. And the basis for everything, the basis for everything is the ability to manipulate play-by-play statistics. If we have the raw data of the play-by-play, we can work miracles. Everything can happen. And imagine that the NBA teams, they have maybe, the Spurs, from what I know, they have 15 people working full-time as the Department of Analytics. So it's a lot of work. And in Europe, you know that we have to be a little more resourceful because no teams have the money and they don't have the resources for this. But there's a lot of room for prediction according to the data that a team has.
So you say, let's say as a EuroLeague team, I want my guard duo, 2 point guards, who will share 40 minutes. Maybe they will play together sometimes. So total they will play 45, 50 minutes. And I want these guys to make total 12 assists every game. Mm-hmm. So I am searching. I select one player from EuroCup and I select another player from Champions League. So by checking their stats and using some metrics, so I can predict their performance next season in EuroLeague. Is it, so you say this will be possible?
Yes, and this is a combination. Right now, today this lecture, it was about quantitative statistics.
Yes.
Quantity, how many? Now we can have the same analysis for quality. We all have Synergy. If we have worked with Synergy, we know pick and roll passer and all these things, yes, what they have. So we can combine qualitative and quantitative, and we can give an estimation. It's an estimation, mm-hmm, of his performance in the future in a higher level. So there can be an estimation. So if we have like two players, as we say, EuroCup and one Champions League, we can combine their quantitative and qualitative data, and from this we can project their career in the future. Maybe no, nobody's going to be 100% ready, yeah, but we can tell you that this guy has a 80% chance to make it. This, yes, guy has a 6% chance to make it.
Okay, thank you very much. One more question: can we use stats, live stats during the game, to give feedbacks to coach in-game decision making?
Yes, this is an area that NBA teams are working a lot, mm-hmm, trying to predict the next play, trying to predict who's going to take the next play and how to predict how the game is going to be. It all depends on the set of data that you have. If you have quick data that comes in live, then there is a chance that you can go on and you can manipulate these things. It takes a lot of computing power from computers. And most of them system works with artificial intelligence and machine learning a lot. Mm-hmm. It's the same way, similar way to how the betting companies calculate the score.
Live bets,
live bets, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's the same quality. There is a model, and the model gets fed with data, and then this model evolves during time, and this is, mm-hmm, how this works.
Ahmet Hocam, yeterli oldu mu cevap? Bu bahise benzer şeyle yapılabilir diyor. Bahis şirketleri gibi. Thank you. Thank you very much, coach.
Teşekkürler.
Başka sorusu olan var mı? Yok gibi. Okay, coach. It was a very interesting and good presentation. Thank you for your time and thank you for sharing your thoughts and knowledge.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jakub, that for you and you bring Coach Christos to us and meet with us. Thank you. It is a great pleasure for us. Coach, we always give the last word to our guest. You can close the live webinar. This is your turn. Okay. Thank you very much for coming to us.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. It was great seeing some faces that some of them are my friends, and I'm very honored to be here with you. And there's a lot of people saying that basketball is not numbers, that players are human beings, and it's not easy to predict human behavior and all these things. I agree with that, but I will close my webinar with one thing. Just remember, score is a number. Anything that has to do with numbers can be predicted, can be worked upon, and can be manipulated. So score is just a number. Although players are playing, are human.
It is great, coach. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Enjoy.
Thank you. Bye. Good luck. And have a healthy days. See you. Bye bye.
Bye.
Teşekkürler Yakup.
İyi akşamlar herkese.
İyi akşamlar.